My name's Matt Dwyer, and I'm the chair of the Department of Computer Science and Engineering here at UNL. Five things that you might want to know about me. I started off not as a computer scientist, but as an electrical engineering undergrad. And one of the first things I did, I think it was in my junior year, is I did an internship at Bausch & Lomb. You probably know this company because of their work in optics. I did some work on data acquisition for mass spectrophotometers, and that's when I kind of got interested in software. I worked for about 8 years in industry. The first 3 years were doing embedded systems development, and then the last 5 years were working on compilers. So I actually built production compilers that people use to build their software products. Then I went on to get my doctoral degree at the University of Massachusetts at Amherst. I'm here to talk to you about computer engineering as a major. It's an exciting field. Obviously, as you know, it's sort of the future. There's a lot of interesting technology sitting on your wrist or in your pocket that is developed by computer engineers. One of the unique things about computer engineering is that it really does sit at this interface between software and hardware. So, for example, this little robot, you might look at it and say, you know, that's hardware, but really there's a microcontroller in here and it's got a lot of software inside of it as well. If you have a mobile phone, which I'm sure you do, you know full well that that's got software on it in the form of apps, it's got an operating system, networking software, as well as a lot of custom hardware. So there's a lot of companies that are building smartwatches nowadays like Pebble, and that's another example of sort of the growing need and challenges and opportunities for computer engineers. In our program, we have four areas of specialization. The first one is embedded systems and robotics, and I'll be showing you some examples of the kinds of projects that students in our program develop in their classes, and then also in collaboration with faculty in their research programs. We also have a focus area on high-performance computing. We have a very large research program that works with physicists and chemists, computational chemists, doing a lot of high-performance data storage and networking and computation there. We also have a focus on signal processing and communication. I'll be talking a little bit about something called sensor networks in a few minutes. And of course, VLSI. In terms of expectations for majors in our program, well, like any engineering discipline, is a challenging one. I'm not going to tell you that it's not hard work, but what it will do is qualify you for some very exciting job opportunities in the future, and in particular ones that have great career prospects in terms of living in interesting places, making a good amount of money, working on exciting and challenging projects. So a computer engineer needs to, of course, understand hardware, kind of like a double E does, but also needs to understand software like a computer scientist does. And in fact, that's one of the most exciting things about computer engineering is you work at this boundary layer between software and hardware. And in fact, the functionality of the system can mix or flow across this boundary. In our program, there's a blend of theoretical work as well as lab work. So if you're the kind of person that likes to get in the lab and build things to try things out, then you'll be a great fit for our program. So let me show you an example of one of the projects that our students develop. In our embedded systems course, students work on some interesting projects. They're given a box of parts and they put together various different kinds of robotic devices. So here's, you can see one on the screen here that's drawing an image. And of course, what's going on here is there's a two-wheeled robotic vehicle, and then there's the ability to raise and lower a pen. It drew a cute little smiley face. So this is the device that was constructed by the students. And if you look closely here, you can see it is really a little breadboard on board the system. Of course, if you look at the system on the screen, you see that sometimes not everything goes perfectly. So you definitely have the opportunity to build interesting things like this. In other instances of this course, students have developed hovercraft and done various sorts of, say, robot competitions, collecting a collecting up balls and defending against other robots, sort of like robot wars. In terms of opportunities that you would have as a computer engineer, turns out that if you talk to our majors, you'll hear really good stories. Our exit interviews show that over the last 4 years, pretty much all of our majors who look for a job get a job. So whether it's going on to grad school or working in industry, we have pretty much 100% employment. Now, a lot of our students, a lot of our graduates decide to stay in Nebraska. In fact, about 60% of them initially decide to take jobs in Nebraska, but a lot of them go other places in the U.S. And just this past year, we had students take jobs on the East Coast, North Carolina, Virginia, Massachusetts, as well as on the West Coast, California, the state of Washington, and also Iowa, Minnesota, and Kansas are some places where our students have gone to work. Of course, the salary levels might vary a little bit depending on the kind of job you take and your willingness to relocate. The data that we have shows that starting salaries for our grads, computer engineering grads, range from about 56 up to 80K. Again, depending on your willingness to relocate. An interesting point, kind of like my experience when I was a student and I took that internship with Bausch & Lomb, is that a lot of our students do internships. Probably about 80% of our students do internships. And for those that do the internships, there's a great advantage. Most of those students, when they come back at the beginning of their senior year, they'll have a job offer in hand. So 3/4 of our students essentially know what they're doing after they graduate at the beginning of their senior year. And that's kind of an interesting beneficial experience for them. There are some great opportunities for students to get involved in our program outside of the classroom. One of the things that we do here in the Computer Science and Engineering Department is we host the regional ACM programming competition. And as a computer engineer, you'll be getting a lot of training in how to write software. So one of the nice things about becoming proficient at writing software is you can get on one of these programming teams and you can compete against other schools in the region. And in fact, we've had teams from the University of Nebraska, Lincoln here, 4 times in the past decade have gone on to the world championships. So teams have gone to China and Russia and Sweden and various other places. So that's fully paid, and it's very exciting because you compete against some of the best young minds in the world. We also have an active chapter of the Association for Computing Machinery and, of course, involvement in UPE. So one of the opportunities that you'll have in terms of getting involved in research projects is the ability to work on sort of cutting-edge applications of computer engineering technology. So I want to show you this device. This is called the Sensor Network Moat. And what's inside of this package here is a custom board that has GPS plus a cell phone chip. It's got battery on there and a bunch of other sensors like altimeter, temperature sensors, and all bundled up in a very small package here. It's contained in a waterproof membrane, and you can see here that it's got the home address, so that if somebody finds it, they can drop it in the mail and it'll get back home. It's also got these two holes here, and these holes allow it to be attached to a crane. This project was the focus of this project was to track the migration of sandhill and whooping cranes. These were deployed in collaboration with avian ecologists. And what the ecologists would do is pick out a captive sandhill crane or one who was a younger bird. And as you can see here, the moats were attached to the back of the plane, right, the back of the crane, right between their wings. Now this guy here is just walking around an enclosure out in Wisconsin, but there were about 10 of these cranes that were equipped with these moats, and then we got the project recorded high-fidelity telemetry for their northern and southerly migration from Wisconsin down to Florida. So the ecologists here, jumping for joy, got much better data than they would have gotten by their traditional means of tracking. Being here in Nebraska, there are many, many opportunities for connecting the kinds of technical development that we undertake in computer engineering with applications that are related to natural resources and agricultural production. So one of the projects that's particularly exciting that's ongoing right now is working on mechanisms that allow the detection of water moisture concentrations so that you can control how the center pivot irrigators apply water so as to minimize the amount of water that's needed to fertilize, to properly irrigate a field. As you can imagine, industry is extremely interested in this, and Dr. Varon has created a spin-out company that is commercializing some of these products. And I just wanted to show you one of their test rigs that they developed. So this doesn't really look, it looks like something that you would build in a lab. But if you look inside, of course, what's going on in here is we have a bunch of custom circuit boards that you can see. And there's water moisture sensors. Now this is buried under the ground below the till depth. And it communicates wirelessly with the center pivot irrigator as it traverses overhead. I said this is a test rig. It's a test rig because this tube here really is a debugging port, because once you bury this device, it's hard to do in-circuit debugging. So this particular rig is set up so that they can monitor the operation of the moat inside. The production rig won't have this, and you'll just bury these in the soil, and they'll communicate wirelessly with the center pivot as it moves across. Another interesting set of research projects that students are heavily involved in involve the department's Nimbus lab. So the Nimbus lab is a lab where they do research on autonomous vehicles. So they're trying to apply these micro aerial vehicles to interesting problems. And one of the areas that they focus on in particular is water quality monitoring. They also do remote crop monitoring. So I brought a couple UAVs here for you to take a look at. This is a tiny little UAV that you can see here, definitely the size of my hand. And in fact, you can fly these around in swarms. This is a pretty capable little guy that can fly for about 15 minutes. The reflectors here on the sides and on the top allow this to be located in space by a series of high-frequency cameras. Now, this much bigger UAV over here is a hexacopter, and what you see here is the additional blades give extra lift capacity and also redundancy, so if a blade breaks, then you can still continue the mission. On the bottom, there's a harness here that allows custom equipment to be attached. And that's exactly what you're seeing in the video. There's a custom rig that's been created that allows, that has a tether that allows the UAV to fly low enough to the water so that it can dip a pump into the water and collect water samples. And people over in on East Campus that do water quality assessment for looking at concentrations of pollutants or bacteria are very interested in using this kind of technology. So in all of these three projects that I've been talking about, undergraduates play a really important role. In fact, in the UAV lab, there are more undergraduates involved in research than there are graduate students. So there's some really compelling and interesting opportunities for you to learn about computer engineering and then apply it to problems that are important in the context of Nebraska.